my previous talks on service a year or two ago, I defined service from the writings of early theosophists like Annie Besant and Alice Bailey. They listed three characteristics of the server, namely harmlessness in speech and action, secondly, willingness to let others serve as seems best to them and work together with others, and thirdly, joyfulness. Annie Besant lectured that even acts of service bind you to the wheel of births and deaths, except for those that are done for the sake of sacrifice. Sacrifice refers to that which is done for the purpose of carrying out the divine will in the world. When you feel yourself part of the one life found in everyone, as Theosophy teaches us, one sacrifices their own ambitions for the universal goal of aiding the less fortunate and afflicted individuals in our society. Such provision of service without the conscious expectation of personal gain is an aspect of karma yoga, which is action rather than meditation. Your practice is to serve other people, but the real spiritual purpose is to serve God. The result will be reflected in soul growth, not personal growth, since your intentions are selfless. The founders of the Theosophical Society placed great importance on concepts like altruism, philanthropy, and self-sacrifice in providing service. In The Voice of the Silence, HPB writes about the path towards illumination and enlightenment. The life of man approaching the path is marked by unselfish service to others, but his willingness to sacrifice all the good of others. Colonel Alcott states, the first step is generous altruism, which can be defined as the selfless concern for the welfare of others. Now, I commenced this activity in my early 20s after graduating from Monash Uni with a major in physics, including first year psychology, followed by a degree doing a master's in meteorology and atmospheric physics. So I never aspired to be a social worker, but that is what I became, as a volunteer with the greatly admired and recommended Brotherhood of St. Lawrence in the poor inner suburb of Fitzroy. And they're still going today doing great work. I had already joined the Melbourne Lodge of the TS, but at that time no one informed me of its Theosophical Order of Service. Having already practiced Hatha Yoga and meditation, I instinctively moved on to service, which is a natural progression after possibly some incarnations as a monk in medieval monasteries, which I vaguely recall. At BSL, I was assigned more of an outreach position to just visit and talk with mainly elderly people who received various forms of assistance from this charity. Such people usually lived alone in a small flat or just a room in a boarding house. This photo up here is of one of their many charity stores, and this is at 274 Brunswick Street, Fitzroy, an area where I spent a fair bit of my childhood through my father's family. Certainly there are guidelines for setting up a practice of service, but I never studied such. Did it really matter that I did not have access to such documentation for learning before carrying out the physical practices? Well, no. True service is a spiritual practice, not a material task. Empathy and other virtues will most likely guide you on the path, so that even a quick decision that normally would be clearly wrong can turn out ultimately to lead to a successful outcome. I have seen this just a few times in my life. This is of the Christ statue in Vung Chau, Vietnam, a country to which I've made five trips since the beginning of the century, as my wife is from Saigon, Vietnam. Someone far more worthy and advanced than me, like Jesus Christ, according to the Christian gospel, severely upset his people, the rulers and law enforcers of his time, to such an extent that even his disciples abandoned him in his moment of need, leading him to lament, "My Lord, why hast thou forsaken me?" But look at the transformation that Christianity over two millennia has brought to the human race. However, I guess the rest of us mortals need a few rules to keep us in check until the present plethora of human laws and regulations became so cumbersome and confusing that even the lawyers can't get it right. So for those who feel they need such, I will summarise how to set up a practice of service by creating in your mind and heart a clear set of conscious intentions based on service and aligned with spiritual laws. Firstly, affirm, I am dedicating to the service of all sentient beings any divine wisdom, knowledge, insight, and spiritual energy that I acquire on the path. Then say, I am using every moment in my life as an opportunity to practice service. Next, I am continually developing and refining the instruments that I use in service by practicing meditation and acquiring wisdom. Lastly, I am utilizing my personal tragedies, sorrows, and suffering experienced in this life as a tool to deepen my practice of meditation. On this last point, I certainly bore more than the normal share of misery, for these experiences allow you to show authentic compassion to others after showing compassion towards yourself. One young lady I had known right through school and a similar man at the Melbourne Lodge of the TS found their experiences in their early 20s so unbearable that they took their own lives. My social work provided some escape from my social failures, which only improved when I moved to Sydney, though I continued doing further service work in counselling. This is the Wayside Chapel in King's Cross, Sydney, originally set up in about 1970 by the Methodist minister, the Reverend Ted Knox. And it's still going today. I worked there voluntarily, helping in the crisis centre, which is mainly a telephone referral centre. We had a few clients actually visit, but much of the work was telephone work, referring them to what was then a small number of various other charity organisations in Sydney in those early 1970s. If you are spontaneously assisting other people who need help without rationally deciding this, you become an instrument of the divine. Unconsciously, you are developing an awareness of the underlying unity of all things without being motivated by personal gain or the need for recognition. You will develop an urge to help as many beings as possible to move on in their evolutionary journey by aiding them to lift themselves out of their black holes of circumstances and false beliefs about their lower selves. Now, this is Swara in Brisbane, which in the early 1980s I volunteered as a mental health supervisor. At Swara, Sunshine Welfare and Remedial Association. I think you can distinguish the two clients of Swara there from the two business ladies on the bottom. They're obviously busy about promoting the place. Well, that was taken in October 1993. Swara was set up by these two lovely ladies, known around Brisbane as the Pink Twins. Moira O'Brien there, and Dorothy O'Brien here. A small kitchen there produced baked goods sold on street stalls, and it was overseen by a competent woman whose single shortcoming was her excessive worries that conditions were not ideal for the output expected. It makes you wonder why, when clients like her generally have a caseworker seeing them regularly, that most managers in government and business don't avail themselves of any guidance on how to manage their emotions. Most of us have experienced unpleasant workplace staff, with few businesses conducting regular emotional management. Now let us move on to how all of us can practice giving service to our community. This is something that everyone here can easily fit into their busy lives without joining any groups or taking up more time. It requires a change in attitude to what is happening in the world now, this very troubled world. All of us here this evening have had an exposure in varying degree to theosophical teachings stretching back a century and a half. They consistently tell us that human evolution is almost at the end of a major cycle called a Kali Yuga. Approaching a new age, our whole planet is suffering through these end times, with the maximum number of material actions, feelings, and thoughts. Accompanying these are corruption, moral degradation, fear, and disputes between one another and our very environment that gives us life. We all need to ask ourselves, are we part of this problem? Or are we going to use our knowledge to rise above it and not have our opinions polarised into just one side of every dispute? As the comedian John Cleese would whisper, don't mention the war! Look back just 1 month and one day to when all adult Australians were required to vote either yes or no to an amendment to our constitution to allow a voice to federal parliament regarding matters affecting our indigenous inhabitants. Sounds simple enough, doesn't it? Well, no. It became polarised into feuding camps, maximising belligerence to each other. The same occurred, maybe to a lesser extent, with the same-sex marriage debate and plebiscite. Those with genuine concern for sensible reforms in our society can easily find themselves in bitter disputes with those believing a different process of reform is superior and the only correct way. We'll look again at the Pink Twins here, born 20 minutes apart, but you can see the countenance on Moya's face here is quite different from Dorothy's. Moya has more of a firmer, determined look. Dorothy, who was director for many years, has a more pleasant countenance, a very loving face. And when she became too old to run the place and retired in the late 90s, twin sister Moya took over for almost another decade. And even though they're born on the same day, a few minutes apart, they became very different characters. I often attended their place over in New Farm, did a bit of odd jobs for them, and they always seemed to be arguing. They could never agree with each other. But in spite of that, they did great things in the world. Both got an Order of Australia for the wonderful work they did that really should have been provided by the government, looking after people with various mental and physical disabilities in a great spectrum of mental incapacity and doing a wonderful job. So even people who can't get along with each other can learn to work together to produce a good outcome. So just what are we supposed to do? Let us return to the start of my talk with the first paragraph, which I'm sure you can not remember. So let me do so for you. These three characteristics of the server: harmlessness, gentleness, willingness to let others serve as best to them and work together with others. That's cooperation. And thirdly, joyfulness from the service you're providing. If you can't be joyful, you should at least feel contentment and satisfaction with how you've at least attempted to help people. Are these characteristics clearly apparent in advocates for current reforms in our society? Clearly not. For a clearer and more profound solution to our doubts over one solution or its polarized opposite, we need to go back, way back, to ancient Sanskrit and its term neti, N-E-T-I, meaning not so. Duplicating these opposites gives us the compound term, neti neti, not this, not that. Do you get it? Both the yes case and the no case for the voice and same-sex marriage are wrong and unworthy of support. Hence, I and many others practice compassion by not voting. Though in the case of the recent referendum, you had to mark the voting paper, but not in the limited way wrongly advised by the Electoral Commissioner. You may write or draw whatever you like in that box, as long as it cannot be mistaken for a yes or a no, which you no doubt disagree with one of them, or maybe both of them, like I did. One Indigenous person from the Kimberley, Western Australia, advised drawing a question mark. So that was good enough for me. The same considerations apply in the climate wards, which as a qualified climate analyst, I will discuss in a future talk on the problems with technology. Neither net zero nor maintaining the use of non-renewable fossil fuels is correct. As the many wise men and women of the enduring cultures of the Indian subcontinent advise, it does not matter what you do in a conflict, the result will be exactly the same. Over several decades in which I was not a member of the Theosophical Society, I followed the devotional path of the Indian guru avatar Satya Sai Baba, who advocated service to our fellow humans and devotional singing to God or the God within, rather than social reform. Thank you for your attention. Hopefully I have given you some insights to consider. Now there's more to come because we're now going to look at some slides from the Theosophical Order of Service. Which one now? Yeah.
Okay, so we just do the little red circle here.
Oh, yeah.
And then go there.
Yeah, that's right. Okay.
And
that should come up on this.
It should come up. Yeah, and then we just use the arrows.
That's it, yeah. So these are donations given in the last financial year that we have. National projects, and the four main ones up there: homeschools in Pakistan, educational sponsorships in the Philippines, Golden Link College, which comes with great recommendations from any of the Westerners that have visited, apparently, and the Syrian refugee project via the TOS in Italy. There's the India Adia Alcott Memorial School, the Adia Animal Dispensary, the Women's Welfare Centre, the HBB Hostel and Odisha Girls Home School. And this is part from the Quandil Homeschool newsletter. I won't read it all out. You can get more information about this later if you want to see Diane or myself. Let me see, it was started as a Montessori school. Photos from some of the national projects in Pakistan, the homeschools. And this is some of the shots of the Golden Link College in the Philippines. And this attracts a matching donation from the Kern Foundation in America. So the Brisbane Lodge has donated a good amount to that project recently. Of course, many of the people in the third world just can't afford the education. They're living on very minimal income, and it's overseas charities quite often that are required to provide some of the necessities that most first world families can afford for their children. And this was set up about a decade ago for Syrian refugees, and there's still strife in Syria, as we know. There we are. I might just go back. Maybe leave it at that one. All right. Now, if you want to get involved in the Theosophical Order of Service, we actually had our main musical concert a couple of weeks ago. Raised quite a bit of money from that, almost $500. And some of you had attended that. And at our annual general meeting of the Brisbane Lodge this year, on the first Saturday of December, we'll be asking for a contribution to the Theosophical Order of Service. And that will be matched dollar for dollar by the lodge. And then that's directed to whatever we think is the most important project at the moment. We have also supported some projects here in Australia, particularly through the need for flood relief, bushfire relief before that, and also our local St. Vincent de Paul Society, which does great job for homeless people and mothers who've had to leave home because of circumstances there and are homeless. Well, only got to 8 o'clock. Does anyone have some questions? Pardon?
Could you tell me about this raffle prizes?
Yes.
8 raffle prizes. Anyone wants to buy a ticket, 3 for $5, and 8 people will win prizes. And Julia here was one that we had 12 prizes on our music night. And
yeah.
She was one of the fortunate ones to win one of the prizes. So
great.
It's well worth it, isn't it?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So did you say how many tickets for $5?
Three
tickets for $5, and there'll be 8 prizes.
Yeah. $2 each, so that probably aren't on the list.
Yes.
We provide a van to pick up injured animals in India, and retired theosophical vets attend to the animals and, you know, either euthanize them or repair them and find homes for them.
Another one is retired engineers have make trikes, so people that have lost limbs, they can actually pedal and still deliver things. They have a little trolley on the back and they can deliver fuel and so forth to the different truck drivers, they call them, or forklift drivers. And one of the other things also is hole in the heart babies come across from Africa, and they're operated in India by retired heart specialists, and the parents and the child are given. So the TOS just isn't in here in Brisbane, it's in every capital city of the world, and all of them have got different projects. But these are the fundamental ones that everyone contributes to, plus their local ones.
Any other questions? So you're going to think about joining the Theosophical Order of Service, Brisbane branch next year?
$2 to join.
How much?
$2.
Just $2?
Yeah.
Bargain.
And we have social events during the year.
Yeah.
We have live theatre we go to together, movies, dinners out. So it's quite a fun thing to belong to.
Yes.
And lovely bunch of people.
We just had a good Saturday afternoon together, well, four of us anyway, seeing a movie at the Palace Theatres, the barracks just behind us here in Paddington, Petrie Terrace area. It was called One Life, which was about a very praiseworthy man back in the late 1930s, a stockbroker in London, who wanted to help some of the refugees that were then in Czechoslovakia back in 1938. As a result of Nazis' occupation of that country prior to the outbreak of the Second World War. And through his work, he was able to rescue 669 of those young children, many of them orphaned, and get them to England and get them put in foster homes. And, of course, they couldn't return to that part of Europe. And it showed how, at the end of the, towards the end of that man's life, played by the well-known actor Anthony Hopkins, and he was asked to clean up his messy office and found some of these things that he hadn't been thinking about for many years, and ended up on a national TV program, and it's a true story. Apparently, the descendants of those 670 children now number 6,000 people that were spared from the terrible atrocities of the Second World War. And there's been a few films over the years about that, and some of the brave people of the time who stood up to terrible things that were happening, like the story about Sophie Scholl, who was a young university student in Nazi Germany, and with a few friends, she quietly campaigned for ending that Second World War and the all the violence that was perpetrated by the Nazis, because it was ruining Germany. It was ruining their country. And 6 years it certainly did. It took the Marshall Plan after the Second World War to restore the country again to a thriving country it is today. But of course, when she and a few students were caught distributing these leaflets at their university, one of the janitor there or something noticed this and informed the Nazis, and of course she was tried and executed along with a few others. But it takes a few brave people like that to stand up to some of the terrible things that happen in the world. Now, I've stood up to various things without getting involved in too much of the demonstrations that end up quite often, as you know, in violence. If you're going to campaign against something in society, you have to do it in a sensible way and not expose yourself to particularly the anger and the polarisation of views that have caused so much trouble in society. But this is the mark of the present age, the Kali Yuga. And there's only some things we can accomplish, and we just have to accept that hopefully things will improve in the next few years. And this is why many of us are incarnate at this time, to help in this transition to a new age and a golden age, which is supposed to go for 1,000 years or something. Well, we'll see. We're never sure when it's going to begin. But I've been involved in the alternative movement since the 70s, whether in conservation or community living, or supporting new ideas in health and education. So we're finishing rather early, unless anyone else wants something to say.
I make myself available if anybody wants to buy a raffle ticket. You know, it's going to a great cause and lots of prizes.
Yeah.
And I think now Nikki's going to come and talk and announce some things that
are happening. Thanks.